On to our next speaker, the missing speaker, the missing link, as it were, which is René Oudmeer.
Thank you. Yeah, it's a little bit of a surprise not to see me, and I thought, how am I going to claim my money? So I'd like to talk about stars today as well, a little bit younger, and concentrate on the formation of intermediate mass stars. And my interest in intermediate mass stars is to actually find out how massive stars form, because that's the bigger surprise. This is all in the context of our ITN that we have. I called it Starry, Stars That Are Young. That's amazing how creative I am on a bicycle going to work in the morning. The PhD students that we hired for this are Miguel Vioque and Alice Perez, and at the moment they're in Madrid. Yeah, I know, I'm just a mover, not a shaker, but I definitely move. So, hi Miguel and Alice, they're now in Madrid. The bottom line is, how do stars form? Classical picture, let's do it in 30 seconds. You've got the molecular cloud, it collapses under its own gravity, gets denser, hotter, star is born, it rotates, starts spinning, we get a disk, and material through this disk is accreting onto the star, and finally, you might even get some planets in these disks. Now, I think it's fair to say that for LOMA stars, we know how the material is going from the star, from the disk to the star, via magnetospheric accretion through the magnetic field lines, material is being dumped onto the star. But for massive stars, we have no idea. We do know that they're not magnetic, for example, so there must be something else going on. There's a couple of other things that that are different between high mass and low mass stars as well, but let's stick to this one for the moment. And from an observational perspective, you'd like to look at massive young stars. And I thought, why don't I just give a little bit of a rundown for the observational issues we have. If we look at young stars that are forming, the Tauri stars, solar mass star, we know they've got this magnetically controlled accretion. We can study them in the optical. When I'm looking at the more massive young stars, because everything happens so quickly, we can't see them in the optical. They're still obscured by the by the dusty clouds in which they were formed. So it's quite difficult to study them. But in the middle, we've got the intermediate mass Herbig AEBE stars, which have masses between, say, 3 and 10 solar masses. So if there's a transition in formation mechanism, it's likely to be around here. And that's why we study these Herbig stars. We can see them in the optical and start studying them. We find a big difference indeed between the lower mass Herbig A stars, say 3 solar masses, and the Herbig B stars, which are 3 to 10 solar masses. An example here is when we're looking at them in polarimetry, spectropolarimetry, we find, I will not go into the details here if you don't mind, we find that the A-type stars have exactly the same features, show the same features in the spectropolarimetry as the Tauri stars, which we can explain with magnetospheric accretion. However, the more massive stars from, say, about 3 solar masses onwards, they do not show any signs of magnetospheric accretion in the polarimetry. Instead, it looks like they've got disks that are reaching close onto the star. Okay, so this was one of the first clues that perhaps this transition from magnetospheric accretion to not is occurring at higher masses than we previously thought. If we then look at other samples of stars, of Herbig stars, and look at their accretion rate, we find that the more massive the star, the higher the accretion rate, which makes probably sense. If you want to become a bigger star, you have to create more material. But there seems to be a break in the slope between low mass stars, around 3 solar masses again, and high mass stars. And the many other studies that have now shown that Herbig B stars, more massive than 3 solar masses, form differently than A stars. Okay, so there must be something going on. And another feature is that some of these Herbig stars are found in clusters, and other ones are not. This is coming from a study by Testi in 1997, who took infrared images of a sample of Herbig stars and found that mostly the Herbig A stars are less likely to be in a cluster than the Herbig B stars, even corrected for the age of these things. It's still a 3-sigma effect. I had to work it out myself. He didn't do it for us. But it's one of these things, so perhaps clusters have something to do with the formation of these massive stars as well. And that's where, yeah, we come in a way, because Nothing has happened since in the field of clustering of these Herbig stars since the studies by TESTI. And of course, Gaia will be of big help because we not only have he only looked at star counts, the stellar densities close to a star, but we can identify clusters in Gaia with the Gaia data. We've got the proper motions and we've got the parallaxes as well. So that's why we started this this little ITN. It's an EID, actually, an industrial network, doctoral network. So I'm just telling you this because we still have some possibilities to apply for it come February. And the idea is, okay, let's now use Gaia to find some proper, to make a proper selection of Herbig stars, because just like with the white dwarfs, everything that we know so far is quite anecdotal, okay? No systematic study of these stars has occurred. And secondly, we can then look for clusters around these stars and see whether they play a role in their formation. Okay, I skip this one. And we used the master sample first. We thought, okay, let's do it in three steps. Let's first characterize everything we know of the Herbig stars so far, so that we then can select new Herbig stars in Gaia. From the master sample of about 240 that is available, we applied all the quality, the parallax quality criteria, got some Bayesian distances, and managed to get 200 objects on the ASAR diagram. And here they are. Quite a lot of low-mass objects, which is fair enough with the IMF. A few high-mass objects. And what I had not anticipated is that the error bars are not on this graph. But now that we've got the distances sorted, I noticed that it's the extinction nowadays to these objects that might actually be the bigger factor in our studies of the ASAR diagram. This is what we just published in 2018. So from the pre-main sequence tracks, you can get the masses of these objects. From the isochrones, you can get a feeling of their ages. And we thought, okay, let's have a look at some of the properties of these objects. And what we found, if we cross-match with WISE to look at the infrared excess of these objects, basically the presence of these disks, then we find that especially the lower mass objects have a lot of infrared excess, have these disks, but the higher ones don't. And if anything, we find a break around 7 solar masses, not the 3 solar masses I was talking about. So it's quite fairly unexpected, to be honest. But when we think about this, the stuff that I just showed you, where the break was at 3 solar masses, we were looking at ionized gas close to the star tracing the accretion. Well, now we're looking at dust further away from the stars. And hot stars, they're very bright, they can actually push away the dust. So the dust evaporation and the clearing of the disk is probably something that we measure here. Another thing that Miguel decided to do, we may have heard, you may have noticed from the first talk, Gaia did do multi-epoch photometry, but only published variability information for a selected subsample of these 1 billion objects. But we can, based on some ideas by Deason et al., we can try to look at the error bar in the photometry and see whether that traces perhaps a variable star. If I've got an eighth magnitude star with a small error bar and an eighth magnitude star with a big error bar in the photometry, chances are it might be variable. So this is what Miguel did. He worked out a variability indicator using the errors and the magnitudes of these objects. And he found that if this indicator is larger than 2, based on objects that we knew about, that we actually do trace a variability of larger than 0.5 magnitudes. And when we then look at the variability, the optical variability of these objects, we have almost a similar picture as I just showed you. The ones with the infrared excess were the low-mass objects, and it's the low-mass objects as well that are variable in the photometry. Okay. Now, it turns out that 25% of all these objects are quite variable. This is probably the most robust number that we found in Herbig stars so far. And then we also trawled the literature and looked at the H-alpha profiles of these objects. And when we're looking at young stars, sometimes you trace inflow of material, you get an inverse P-Cygni profile. Sometimes you find outflows in the objects, that's a polar wind, you get a P-Cygni profile. And sometimes you find double peak profiles, which might trace rotating disks. Turns out that all our variable objects show almost all of our objects, variable objects, show a double peak profile. So for some reason, these variable objects are surrounded by rotating disks. So we probably see a disk in the line of sight. And they have a lot of infrared excess. And then I have to go back to a phenomenon that was explained based on very indirect evidence, even more indirect than I'm showing now, where people found that if you have variability in Herbig stars, it could be due to a rotating dust cloud around an object. And this, although indirect, is statistically probably the biggest support of that notion so far. Okay. Now then, coming back to the clusters, this is ongoing now. Turns out it's not very easy to detect clusters around Herbig stars because most clusters that we know from Gaia have hundreds of members. You can use all kinds of nice statistical methods to find these objects. But in our case, we're looking at perhaps at most a dozen or 20 objects. Not very easy, but I'd like to give you an idea anyway what we're doing. Because if we know where the Herbig star is, then at least we know where a putative cluster should be. We know its parallax. We know its proper motion. And this is, for example, input data. We look at an object here. I've got the name here. This is an all objects within, I think, yeah, within one degree of it. How do we select the cluster? This is the distribution of all the parallaxes around this object. You can see it peaks towards zero because most objects are far away. This is the proper motion of right ascension, peaks around zero because most objects are far away. And this is the proper motion in declination, exactly the same, peaks at zero. But for our object, we know that the parallax is around here. You can already see a kind of an excess of objects here at that parallax. Its proper motion is here, its proper motion is there. And if we then select on that, let me zoom in, I'm not going to show you the final result, then we can actually retrieve a cluster around this object. We've got a peak in the proper motions that we would expect, peak in the proper motions there and here. And if I'm looking at the density of objects around this object, we actually see there's an enhancement, an overdensity of stars close to the Herbig star, giving us already an idea that perhaps this one has a cluster. We are going to repeat this for 200 objects and then try to improve on what Testi did. This is, you can see the ones in dark blue are the ones at the parallax that I expect. Here we've got the main sequence, and this is our main object. And here we can see that all the objects are clustering in proper motion in RA and DEC. Two slides. How do we find new Herbig stars? Similar problems as the white dwarfs. They look a lot, but here they look a lot like other objects. Here I'm giving an idea of the infrared excess, H minus K, of objects compared to the R minus H alpha from IFOS. H alpha gives you an indication, do we have emission in H alpha not, which you would expect for a Herbig AE BE star because they've got emission. Here in blue we've got the Herbig stars. You can see they've got an excess in the dust, an excess in the H alpha, and the normal stars. But there's a huge overlap. We can do this by eye, but we can also do some machine learning here. And using a neural network already based on this, I think now I know something is actually went wrong in the transferring the file, but this shows exactly this diagram and the results from the machine learning. And now we can, of course, change the numbers and be very compelling. But basically, the machine learning based on this graph said everything in this direction, the chances are larger than 50% that they're not a Herbig star. And if they're in this direction, it's larger than 50% that they are. Well, that's not very conclusive, but this is based, this what you can't see, is based on only two input catalogs. So now we want to move on, use the HR diagram, look at the variability, etc., and do the neural network in n dimensions. We went up to 10 or something like that. That's something that we cannot really process with our own eyes. Okay, so conclusions based on the last 10 minutes. I hope to have convinced you that the Herbig AB stars bridge the gap between the low-mass stars and the high-mass stars and give us a lot of information about massive star formation. We were able to put 200 objects already in SR diagram. We found that the dust is probably being evaporated by the hotter stars due to the radiation pressure in a slightly different way than what we would see for the break at three solar masses. We found already some very nice indirect but quantitatively large sample support for an explanation for the Axel phenomenon. And we now, in the STARRY project, are trying to find new Herbig stars and study the clusters around those. And with the last slide, which is just an advert for conference next year, I'll leave it at this. Thank you very much.